Doesn't look very impressive, does it?
No, just heaps and heaps of rocks, really.
No wonder this place went unnoticed for generations and generations. Just anybody passing this by would just think, that's just a heap of rocks.
Yeah, I agree. And it's not the heap that you think something was here. It's just really like regular formless rocks, you know what I mean?
Yeah, that's what it looks like. Until somebody, not that long ago, flew above this place and saw something very unique. Let's take a look, shall we?
Today, we're visiting the Stonehenge of the Middle East. It is the largest monolithic structure in this region. Five concentric circles built of 42,000 rocks, and an ancient chamber in the middle of it all.
Whoa! How did they get this rock here?
And a window with a mysterious cosmic purpose. The terrain here is so rocky that we can barely pass with our SUV.
Whoa. Look at those rocks. Yo.
So how in the world did they transfer 42,000 rocks with the limited technology they had 5,000 years ago? And even more interesting, you can't see this place from a human height. There are no hills around, no mountains. So whoever built it, they couldn't see the circles. So how did they construct them in such perfect radius? And who did they do it for? What was the purpose of this place? In this episode, we go on a quest to find the answers to one of the greatest archaeological mysteries of the Middle East.
It's about a kilometer and a half from the main road, but all of it is on a rocky, bumpy ground like this one, and there are some big holes in it. So if you come in a small vehicle, it's possible, but extremely challenging.
This is nerve-wracking. This car was not made for this.
Whoa.
We actually wanted to come here for quite a while now, but we couldn't. Because this place is located in the military training zone in the Golan Heights. So you can't just come here at any time. Entrance is allowed only on the weekends. And even then, if you want to fly your drone here so you could see those beautiful circles from above, you can't. You need to have Israeli drone license, operator's permit, you need to have permission from the military. So luckily for us today, we joined the Israeli Drone Association, which collaborated with the IDF to close the airspace so that a few of us can fly our drones here.
So this place is called Rujmil Hirri in Arabic, which means the stone heaps of the wild cats. Nobody really knows why it was called this way, but that's how it appears on the ancient Syrian maps.
The Hebrew name of this site, Gilgal Rephaim, literally means the wheel of giants. And it brought a lot of attention to this place because Rephaim is mentioned in the Bible in relation to the race of a very tall people, the giants. It is very important to understand that this name was given recently to this site. So it cannot be used as evidence to prove anything. Because I've seen a lot of videos out there online which take the name for this place, and that's how they connect this place to biblical accounts about Rephaim. But that cannot be used as evidence. We need to rely on archaeological and historical evidence to find out the truth. This place is a subject to much dispute and opinion. There's only about one thing that scientists agree on. It was built around the year 3000 BC. This ancient structure is built of five concentric circles. The outer circle has a diameter of 156 meters,
roughly 500 feet. That makes it the largest megalithic structure in the Middle East. It is estimated to have about 42,000 rocks, weighing up to 40,000 tons.
Here is a really cool thing about this place. In the center of all the circles, there is a large heap of stones, about 13 feet high. From a side, it doesn't look very impressive, but once you climb on top of it, you realize that's not just a heap of stones. It is some type of a building with a chamber inside. It has a window and it has steps leading towards some type of an entrance, so we can actually go inside of it.
Wow. Put your hand. Okay. Oh my gosh. Oh, this is not a place I want to be in. This place looks like it has a lot of spiders. I do not like spiders.
Whoa. This is... Wow.
Look, there's candles, so I think people did here some sort of ceremonies, and I see a star.
So you see, this is the window from where the ray of the sun comes in only once a year. Any other time of year, it's like this. See, the sun is up there, and this window you have sun here, but not inside the chamber. But only once a year, sun goes through.
In the center chamber of the Gilgal Rephaim, archaeologists found a window which has a very unique purpose. It only allows the sun rays to enter on the longest day in a year, the summer solstice. And here is how it works. The window is built in a very specific angle, with very thick walls, so that the sun rays are blocked from entering the chamber on all days of the year except just one, the solstice day, in which the earth achieves its maximum axial tilt and thus lets the sun shine through the window and into the chamber.
Man, it's incredible they had the knowledge. I don't have the knowledge how to do that, actually. If I wanted to, I wouldn't know where to put the window, at what day of the year, and how to build this. No way in my lifetime I'd be able to figure out by myself. How did they know this?
We gave it a farther thought. To build this window, one would need to know which day of the year is the longest. And since a clock that would measure the hours and minutes of the day was not invented yet for another millennia, they would have to use something different, yet very precise.
So, imagine this is our plateau. This is the ground, you know, in the mountain. The easiest way to find the longest day in the year would be to take a pole, stick it in the ground, and then when the sun rises, it would cast a shadow. When the sun reaches its midday, you'll just trace the shadow until it's the shortest in that day, and you mark it on the ground. So let's say shadow gets up to here. The next day, the sun is gonna go a little bit farther into the horizon as the earth tilts, and now the shadow goes over here. So now we've got another line a little farther during the noonday. And it continues doing so, and you can measure throughout the entire year your shadows, and you can find when the shadow is the longest and the shortest, and that would be an indication what is the longest day and the shortest day in that year. This is actually how the Egyptian people had their first kind of a time measuring device, where they would divide the day into two sections, before the noon and afternoon. This actually takes quite some intelligence to figure out. Another proof that the people that lived there 5,000 years ago were not as primitive as one would assume. So here is the greatest mystery about this place. It is built on a very large plateau. There are no hills or mountains anywhere close. So it's not like you can go up on some hill and look down and say, oh, look how pretty this thing looks. Whoever built it knew that the regular human cannot see the formation from the ground.
It is hard to speculate, but there are two main theories explaining the purpose of the circles. One interesting theory suggests the circles were built for the purpose of idol worship, like the Tumuz and Ishtar, the gods of fertility, believing that the gods could see the circles from above. The other theory, that is very interesting, suggests that this structure was built with the help of a very tall people, who could see the circles much better than an average person.
In the book of Deuteronomy chapter 3, the Bible tells us about Og, king of Bashan, being a very tall person. The text says that his bed was 13.5 feet long. That's 4 meters. Now, Bashan, the area, is actually today's Golan Heights, so he lived here. And then the text goes on saying that he was the last descendant of the Rephaim. The Rephaim is the race of exceptionally tall people. So if Og, king of Bashan, was to stand next to these circles, would he be able to see them all from his height?
So we decided to conduct a test. We raised the drone to my height, 6 feet and 3 inches, roughly 1.9 meters. At this height, you can't see any circles, just a heap of stones. Next, let's raise the drone to the altitude of 13 feet, that's 4 meters in elevation, and see how it would look like from the eyes of Og.
This is really, really cool because we can actually start seeing the circles from this height. And imagine if we cut down the weeds, you'd be able to see them even in a better way. One could argue that Og lived 2,000 years after the structure was built. But that's actually good for this theory, because it is very plausible that Og's great-great-great-great-grandpa was a little taller than him, and he would even be able to see this place better. And there's also another biblical text in the book of Numbers that says that the Israelites seemed to themselves as grasshoppers in front of these giants.
That's how I feel like next to you, always needing to look up like that. Gives me neck cramps sometimes.
I'm not that tall.
Mm-hmm. Cute.
Today, we're left with more questions than answers. This place has so many mysteries, like the small hatch in the mound that points to specific coordinates on Mount Hermon, a place that we're yet to explore. In the end of the day, we're leaving here with one conclusion, that we must return. For we have only scratched the surface behind the mysteries of Gilgal Rephaim.
I can't believe you don't like spiders. Spiders are actually nice, you know? They live in king's palaces. I read this today.
Where'd you read it?
In Proverbs.
Oh, that's
spiders
true.
Spiders live in king's palaces.
Because nobody can get up there with a broom.